Yes, good afternoon, and thank you for your very generous introduction. Thank you, chairpersons, Dr. Jaideep, Dr. Dhiren Joshi, Dr. Ramkesh. And after a very elegant and mesmerizing talk by a close friend, Sanjay Kalra, who talked about the glucose-centric approach, or rather what he described as a glucose-optimized approach, it is very difficult to move away from that to an approach that I am going to talk about, that is lipid-centric approach. And followed by this, there will be a talk by Dr. Narasingh Verma about a triglyceride-centric approach. So I hope that we do not confuse you more. I'll be talking about the importance of LDL and the lipid lowering in our diabetes practice. May I be allowed to share my screen now? Okay. So is my screen visible?
Yes, sir.
Yes?
Yes, sir.
So the disclaimer I have
made is visible.
AstraZeneca sponsored symposium, or rather the talk. But the views that I'll be expressing would be my own. So we know that diabetes is not only a disease of glucose, it's a cardiovascular as well as the renal disease. And Dr. Sanjay Kalra in his talk very clearly demonstrated that glucose control is extremely important. And if you control glucose with an agent that gives you additional benefit, is going to be welcome in 21st century, obviously. 2 out of 3 of our diabetic patients eventually die due to a cardiovascular event. And now in cardiovascular event, we understand that it is not only atherosclerosis, but also heart failure, which may or may not be related directly to atherosclerosis. People with diabetes, we know, are 2 to 4 times more likely to have cardiovascular disease. And it is one of the highest cause of mortality and morbidity in our Indian population. There are so many factors that attribute to the cardiovascular mortality in our diabetic patients. It is the leading cause of death in our country. It's responsible for about 1 out of 4 deaths overall. And in diabetic, you can say 2 out of 3 deaths. And amongst the most important causes for cardiovascular disease, dyslipidemia is the biggest risk factor for atherosclerosis and subsequent cardiovascular disease. And amongst the total cholesterol as well as the other lipid levels, LDL has drawn the primary focus, and that is why it is the primary goal to treat LDL to the target so as to reduce the cardiovascular events in our diabetic as well as non-diabetic people. We know that this slide you have seen from Stephen Hefner several times, that a person without diabetes having a myocardial infarction or cardiovascular disease, the risk is in diabetic people without cardiovascular disease almost equal. And if diabetic person has cardiovascular disease, the risk is multiple times more. And the cardiovascular event rate is linearly related to the rising level of cholesterol and is 4 to 5 times higher in diabetics versus non-diabetics. This was published in JAMA 1976, when we did not have subfragmentation like LDL, HDL, non-HDL, all this. So at that time, even total cholesterol was considered to be one of the most important factors responsible for the cardiovascular events. In our country, there are some typical risk factors for diabetes as well as cardiovascular disease. There is a clustering of these factors. Advanced age, obviously, is a risk factor. Male gender is a risk factor. Positive family history is a big risk factor. The urban residence and the problems associated with urbanization, the stress, the modern lifestyle, diet, again, is a risk factor. Abdominal obesity, hypertension, the income status, overall obesity, all these are important risk factors, not only in diabetic, but also in non-diabetic people for cardiovascular disease, as well as for the causation of hyperglycemia also. The typical Indian phenotype, we very well know that we have greater abdominal obesity. That's why higher insulin resistance. We have high waist circumference, though we may not be generalized obese, but we have central obesity, high waist circumference, and that is characteristic of increasing the susceptibility to type 2 diabetes atherosclerosis, cardiovascular disease, hypertension, so many other things. The very typical dyslipidemia in our Indian people is high triglyceride, low HDL, and high small dense LDL. Our total LDL may not be as high as the Caucasians, but whatever LDL we harbor is atherogenic or small dense LDL, and together with low HDL, it makes the risk very, very significant. Yesterday only, Dr. Mohan, in his precision diabetes oration, very well described that this is a typical phenotype we Indians are having of low HDL. This much low HDL is not found in any other population, not even other Asian population. So there are so many challenges. We have high visceral fat at any given BMI, high waist circumference, high waist to hip, as well as high waist to height ratio. There's low level of adipokine, high level of leptin, low rate of glucose disposal, impaired insulin secretion, as well as insulin resistance, which is increased. So the combination of low insulin secretion, increased insulin resistance is accountable to not only type 2 diabetes, but also atherosclerosis. How do we manage diabetic dyslipidemia? Is it different from managing the other dyslipidemias? Well, first of all, we know that the risk of cardiovascular disease is very high for our Indian patients. The small dense LDL contributes a lot. And compared to the Europeans, cardiovascular disease affects us a decade earlier. And that's why we need to be early. We need to be aggressive early on rather than at the age of 40. Because most of the guidelines recommend starting of statin therapy at the age of 40 or above. But this should be lowered to 30 or even younger. Because a very recent article showed us that it is the cumulative effect of the elevated LDL that is responsible for atherosclerosis as well as the cardiovascular disease. So if at a younger age, your LDL is high or your cholesterol is abnormal, you are going to have a long time hyperlipidemia or elevated LDL, which is responsible for the plaque burden or the overall formation of the plaques responsible for the cardiovascular event. In India, again, the cardiovascular disease mortality is also very high and again at a very young age. Amongst the risk factors there are, dyslipidemia is the strongest contributor to the Indian cardiovascular risk. You can see here that smoking, exercising, diabetes, abdominal obesity, all these are risk factors, but amongst them, lipids are the biggest risk factor, and that was shown in the Inter-Heart study where dyslipidemia contributed highest as far as the myocardial infarction in Indians was concerned. Unfortunately, the dyslipidemia incidence in our country is extremely high in diabetic patients, almost about 80%. And in our own analysis, which we did 5 years back and 15 years back, about 85 to 90% of our male and female are having some form of dyslipidemia according to the newer definition. Unfortunately, in spite of being on statin, hardly 50% of the patients achieve goal. So less than 50% are prescribed statin, and amongst those who are prescribed statin, less than 50% achieve the goal because they are not given the appropriate dosage. Moreover, the combination of statin plus other lipid-lowering agents is very, very high for unknown reasons in our country, especially statin plus fibrate, which is used in combination where statin dose becomes inadequate, and that is why the people are not able to achieve the LDL goal. So there is a need for appropriate treatment for our Indian diabetic dyslipidemia patients. The lipid-lowering therapy accounts for more than 70% of the cardiovascular risk reduction in diabetic patients. This is the most important slide. You can skip all other slides and just can concentrate on this slide, which is derived from the Steno 2 study and calculated using the UK PDS risk engine, where they showed that we can reduce the cardiovascular risk of a diabetic patient by controlling glucose, by controlling blood pressure, by controlling lipids, by reducing smoking or avoiding smoking, and by reducing the weight or the albumin excretion. Amongst all these modifiable risk factors, LDL lowering assumes the greatest importance. You can see that more than 70% contribution of the CV event reduction comes from the LDL reduction. In other words, if you want to reduce the cardiovascular risk by, say, 50%, 40% will be contributed by lipid lowering. The rest of the players will contribute only 10%. In other words, in a cricket match, if we have a player like Virat Kohli, if you have to score 200 runs, 150 will be scored by Virat Kohli. The rest of the players will contribute only 50. So that is how you can understand that how important it is to control the cholesterol levels, especially the LDL levels, so as to reduce the cardiovascular risk. And this is also the safest, most trusted, most evidence-based, and the most economical way of reducing the cardiovascular risk in diabetic patients. Every 1 millimole of LDL reduces the risk of major vascular events by about 21%. This was published in Lancet 2015. The major events by 24%, revascularization 24%, stroke also by 15%, any vascular death 12%, any death 9%, and overall vascular events 21%. So a significant reduction can be achieved by just merely reducing the LDL by 1 millimole. What do the guidelines recommend for management of the cardiovascular risk? Well, obviously, all the guidelines recommend LDL as a primary target of therapy. Our Lipid Association of India also recommends LDL as a primary target and non-HDL as a co-primary target, which I think is also extremely important. But if you can lower LDL, obviously, the non-HDL is going to go down in most of the patients. Lower the LDL, better it is. And now we have proven pharmacotherapy options for that. 50% or more lowering of LDL is associated with a significant reduction in the cardiovascular risk we'll discuss. And that is why the new guidelines, as well as the India aim, is for reducing LDL by more than 50%. Dr. Bansi Sabu and colleagues have taken up this initiative of reducing LDL by 50% or more. Whatever score you calculate, whether European score or ACC, or probably the QRISC-3 or JBS, which is probably more representative of risk in our Indian population, but you need to stratify whether the patient is in high risk group or in the moderate risk group. I'm not talking about low risk group because there is nothing like low risk in our Indian diabetic people. Low risk people can be if the calculated score is less than 1%, which I don't think any diabetic patient is going to have. There the target can be less than 116. Otherwise, moderate risk target should be below 100. I'm not going into how the risk is classified because all of you know it. High risk, the target should be below 70. And I think all our patients belong to this category. Unless they are having a cardiovascular event already, they become very high or extreme risk, where target of less than 55 or even less than 30, according to the Indian guidelines, becomes the target LDL for reducing the cardiovascular event significantly. The ACC guidelines also recommend 50% LDL reduction for optimal ASCVD risk reduction, especially when LDL is more than 190 or diabetes with additional risk factor. One should be giving a high intensity statin rather than a normal intensity or a moderate intensity statin. The next talk is on triglycerides, so I'm not going to talk about that. But even with triglycerides more than 200 but less than 500, statins are recommended as first drug of choice. It should not be fibrate. Fibrates are indicated only when TG is more than 500 or on top of optimum dose statin or maximally tolerated dose statin. If the TG remains high, then only try the fibrate or maybe saroglitazar or maybe ezetimibe or some other drug may come into picture. These days, there is a trend of omega-3 fatty acids, especially EPA, in the Western countries. Unfortunately, that is not available in the form it was studied in the reduced diet in our country. Sorry. So how do we consider what dose of statin to be given? Well, type 1 diabetes, more than 10 years of duration, and having abnormal LDL, age more than 25 or 30, they are considered high or very high risk. Type 2 diabetes, any patient more than 30 years of age, having LDL more than 70, I think they are the drugs. They are the population that should be considered for therapy. If the goal is not achieved with statin, optimum or maximal tolerated dose, ezetimibe can be considered in these patients. Now, coming back to the 50% LDL reduction, and you can see that the LDL reduction of more than 50% can reduce the cardiovascular event rate by 57%. If you reduce it by just 20 or 30%, the risk reduction is not great, from 11.2 baseline to 4.8, 57%. Whereas with 20% or 30% LDL reduction, you would hardly achieve 30% reduction in the cardiovascular risk. And the number needed to treat also changes significantly when you can achieve 50% or more reduction in the LDL. You can see that 26, if the LDL reduction is 50%, compared to 63 number needed to treat if you can achieve just 20% LDL reduction. How do we consider the intensity of statin? Young person, no risk factors, LDL less than 100, no therapy may be recommended. Probably this needs to be changed to 30 years for our Indian patients. I'd like to have opinion from the experts. If patient has risk factor more than 20% ASCVD risk, obviously high intensity statin. More than 40 years of age, ASCVD risk not high, moderate statin. And if the risk is high, obviously high intensity statin. What does high intensity statin mean? Rosuva 20 to 40, Atorva 40 to 80. Rest of the doses or the statins qualify for the moderate intensity statin. Are there benefits with combination therapy? There are no benefits. Statin plus fibrate, none of the trial has shown robust benefit. Statin plus niacin is out of equation now. Statin plus ezetimibe in the improved study showed some benefit, and ezetimibe being a very safe drug, probably that asks for a good combination if your LDL is not coming down with the highest tolerated dose. Now, among statin, which is the right statin? At present, we have mainly rosuvastatin and atorvastatin that are very popular in the market. And this study done in diabetic population showed us, the Uranus trial, that in type 2 diabetic with baseline A1C LDL of more than 127, rosuvastatin 10 to 40 milligram was 50% more effective than atorvastatin, which means that in our Indian patients, again, we need a potent statin. Rosuvastatin scores over atorvastatin with equal degree of safety. How can we ensure better efficacy or outcome? Now, amongst the statin, we now clearly know that rosuvastatin has an edge over atorvastatin as far as the potency is concerned. But amongst the rosuvastatins which are available, does the innovator statin offer some advantage? The innovator molecule obviously comes with an advantage. It can ensure the drug availability within the specified statistical process control limit, both upper as well as lower. If it is lower in the generics, it does not make the drug efficacious. If it is higher, it makes the drug unsafe. So we need to be in this narrow range of upper and lower specification. The generic molecules sometimes are not within this range. They may be either less effective or they may be extremely more effective, making the drug unsafe. The safety is mainly related to the impurities that are contained in the drugs. And we very well know about the atorvastatin, losartan, even ranitidine and certain other molecules, other sartans also, that the methylated impurity, the NDMA impurities, not only reduces their efficacy, but are also associated with some carcinogenic or other effects. And that is why it is worthwhile using a pure molecule. A generic statin does not fit the HMG-CoA reductase inhibition because of the presence of methylated impurity in the generics. And that's why there is every reason to use the original compared to the generic molecules. Is there a scientific or a clinical research evidence that the innovator versus the generic, the cardiovascular risk will be more? This is a study from Spain which showed us that compared to the generic statin, the branded statin are associated with 31% reduction in the cardiovascular risk. So compared to innovator statin, probability of suffering a cardiovascular event was 31% higher in the generic statin. So that is all the more reason to use the innovator brand compared to the generic brand. And when the cost difference is not that significant, and we know that it is most important to treat the LDL to the target, I think it calls for a definite need to use the innovator statin. You can see that the impurities can be in form of lactone, it can be in form of keto acid, anti-SOMR. So whatever impurities are, it will not reduce the efficacy, it will also increase the side effects, and it will reduce the overall shelf life of that particular product. So to sum up, we know that early and intensive treatment is required. Early, why? Because longer the duration of LDL rise, more will be the atherosclerotic This is last slide. The recommend LDL goals based on the patient risk and the cardiovascular event. Give the maximal tolerated dose and achieve the target. Rosuvastatin is a more potent and safer statin. And amongst the rosuvastatins, using the innovator is associated with less event risk. Thank you very much for your very kind audience. It's over to you.